All I wanna say, God's good.
And he was buried in the grave. And from the grave there were shouts of Hosanna. And the stones could not hold him down. And the saints could not stay in the earth again. The earth has to give way like a quake. And the body of the saints resurrected in Jerusalem and went and appeared to so many and then took off. Jesus is alive. What makes Christianity Christianity is the fact that Jesus is alive. All other prophets prophesied and died and they remained dead. But Jesus prophesied, died, and resurrected.
Hosanna. And the stones could not hold him down. And the saints could not stay in the earth again. The earth has to give way like a quake. And the body of the saints resurrected in Jerusalem and went and appeared to so many and then took off. Jesus is alive. What makes Christianity Christianity is the fact that Jesus is alive. All other prophets prophesied and died and they remain dead. But Jesus prophesied, died, and resurrected. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is alive. Death has lost its victory, and the grave has been denied. Jesus is forever. He's alive. He's alive.
He's the Alpha and Omega.
First and last.
First and last is he.
The cause of sin.
The cause of sin.
The Lamb of God is risen.
The Lamb of God is risen.
Come on.
He's alive. He's alive.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Jesus is alive.
Death has lost its
victory. Death has lost its victory. And your breath has been denied. Jesus is forever.
He's alive.
He's alive.
Praise the Lord. Whatsoever is in your body that seems to resist the power of resurrection, because Jesus is alive today, all grave-clothed situations in your life, they are giving way to the power of resurrection. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. The God I know and the God I serve and the God of this great ministry and mission under the Archbishop Benson Edahosa, which anointing could quake the world, that same God is alive here today. And he's turning every negative situation in your life to positive. Tell your neighbor there is good news today. There is good news today. Tell him the Egyptians you saw yesterday, Pharaoh you saw yesterday, that Pharaoh that held you in slavery, you shall see them no more from today and forever. Take your seats, glorious. Amen. Acts chapter 4. Verse 16, notable miracle. Acts chapter 4. I can see my brother looking so gallant. I couldn't recognize you. It's good to be married. Reverend, congratulations once again. All right. Acts chapter 4, verse 16. And my sister, you're also welcome. You are very much welcome to this place. Acts chapter 4, verse 16. Are you there? All right, can we read it together? Saying, what shall we do to these men? For that indeed a notable miracle had been done by them is manifest to all them that dwell in Jerusalem. And we cannot deny it. Look at 17. But that it spread no further among the people, let us straightway threaten them, that they speak henceforth to no man in this name. Notable miracle. A notable miracle is a remarkable miracle. It is a noticeable miracle. It is not done in darkness, it's done in the light. A noticeable miracle is memorable. It can never escape your memory for life. It remains indelible in your life. And anytime the memory comes, there is an activation and a reactivation of the miracle in reality. Praise the name of the Lord. A notable miracle is a plain miracle. You don't need further explanations to explain a notable miracle. Everybody sees it. Everybody believes it. No man can deny it. Praise the name of the Lord. You can deny the one who performs the notable miracle, but you cannot deny the fact of the miracle. Praise the name of the Lord. It remains undeniable. Number two, you can never stop the spread of the information bordering on the performance of a notable miracle. They said, let us stop this message that it spreads no further. But if you read down that scripture, the Bible tells us that the more they attempted to stop it, the message spread like wildfire. And many were added to the church. How? A notable miracle is what you cannot stop. What then is a notable miracle? John chapter 11 verse 25. What is a notable miracle? John 11, 25. Jesus said unto her, now look at verse 23. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. 25. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live again. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? Praise the name of the Lord. What is a noticeable miracle and what is a notable miracle? A miracle occurs in the life of a person to give life to that person. If somebody's hand is short and suddenly that hand becomes lengthened to be equal to the one that was before, what has happened to that person is that real life concerning the size of his hand has been added. You call that a miracle. So a miracle is the true, notable miracle is the true restoration of life to a fallen state. And that's why Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Meaning that every man in the Adamic nature lives in a dead state. Everyone lives in a dead state, so everyone needs the miracle, a notable miracle, to be translated to the living state. How can this be? It is only by the power of the resurrection. The power of the resurrection can never be underestimated at all times. It has the ability to give life and to add life. If somebody is blind and the two eyes pops out, you say it's a miracle, a notable miracle. But what has happened in the life of that person? Life has been added to that person in the eyes. So a notable miracle has to do with the restoration and the addition of life to life. Praise the name of the Lord. And the available tool to assess this notable miracle is called belief. Everybody say belief. Jesus said, believest thou this? In the kingdom of God, the only valid currency a believer carries is belief. If thou canst believe, all things are possible. What hinders you from your notable miracle is your belief. It's not the church you attend. It's not the pastor you have. Your belief separates you from your miracle. The day you make up your mind to believe that story of the word that is either written or coming from the altar, you have a notable miracle instantly. Belief is the only meal ticket to be ever relevant in the kingdom. As long as you want to eat in the kingdom, you must not throw away that meal ticket called belief. The day you throw your meal ticket away, you are on your own. Nobody goes to the ATM machine and puts an inaccessible card into it. It will tell you error, which means you can't withdraw any money. The same thing goes in the kingdom. When you appear before the throne of God, what is looking for is that your ATM card called belief. When you slot in that belief, and the belief is in line with the word of God, then God has no hesitation than to confirm his word. The confirmation of his word is called notable miracles that takes place in your life. Praise the name of the Lord. Everyone needs a notable miracle. It must have been in your job, in your marriage, in every aspect of life you don't want to discuss with somebody. But you need a notable miracle. How can this notable miracle be done? Once again, belief is the key. Like I said, The essence of a miracle is to add life to you and to give you and to restore life to you. Now let's see what Jesus said in John 10:10 about life. Look at John 10:10. It says, let's read from verse 7. Then said Jesus unto them, again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. 10. The thief cometh not, but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and they that they might have it more abundantly. The greatest miracle that can happen to any person is the gift of life. When a man is dead, history is ended. But as long as a man is alive, history will still one day repeat itself. Jesus said, I came to give you notable miracle, life. And what is the kind of life that Jesus brought on the day of resurrection? He himself calls it abundant life. What is abundant life? Abundant life is a life that has no comma. Abundant life is a full stop to every negative situation. Abundant life is the life that Jesus exhibited as an example when he was on it. He was the Word made flesh. And Jesus is our perfect example. How? He did not just come to live and perform ministry for 3.5 years and to go back. But all what Jesus did for 3.5 years is for our example. And what was the example of Jesus when he came to abundant life? Jesus had no personal building of his own. Yet you can't call him a poor man. He had no money to pay tax. Yet when it was time to pay tax, he called the fish to bring the money. Abundant life means you are controlling life and life is not controlling you. Abundant life means you have exited outside the realm of the troubles of life and you are in the resting place of God where you dictate to life, not life dictating to you. Abundant life would look at sickness and say, now get out in the name of Jesus Christ, and sickness will obey. Abundant life will say, like our elder Abel, God, you have given me a covenant. This is not the way I am going to go. And the situation changed immediately. Abundant life takes charge. Abundant life does not sit under. Jesus was in control of everything. There was nothing he needed that he did not get. Nothing, absolutely nothing that Jesus needed that he did not get. When a man is poor financially, money is controlling his life. Because money dictates to you what to eat and what to buy. When you get to the market, it's not as if you don't have taste. But because money is the one controlling your life financially, the money decides for you what to buy for soup for that day. Praise the Lord. That is not the life Jesus promised us. He said, you shall have life in word abundance. Abundance means everything. Financial, marital, everything. You shall blossom like I did on earth. Abundant life is abundant life. When a rich man gets to the market, because he knows he has money, he's bold to price anything. How much is this fish? But when the poor man gets to, it's not as if he doesn't like the fish. The child is drawing, daddy, 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 see the mommy, see this fish now, let's buy. No, no, this, like, there is another one there. What is happening? You do trouble me. Then before you know, you spank that, bah, the child begins to cry. Everybody say, why is this child crying? Say, leave her alone, too stubborn. It's not about the stubbornness of the child. Something is happening. Abundant life is not in control. Financially, something is controlling something. And that person is running away from the reality, because if I price the fish and they finally say, okay, I've agreed, bring the money, there is a problem. So I better dodge. Praise the Lord. Abundant life was what Adam possessed initially in the garden. Do you know that from scripture, I never saw anywhere that Adam prayed for anything? Adam never one day held a night vigil for anything. He didn't kneel down to ask for anything. How? Because before he was brought in, God has finished everything. And he put him to control dominion. In scripture, Adam only had one business with God. Let's say two. One, to dress the garden and keep it. Number two, worship. The Bible says every evening the Lord will come down to fellowship with him in the cool of the evening. That was worship. So Adam's business was not, what shall we eat tomorrow? No. What shall we eat tomorrow propels you to whole night vigil. Because you have not understood John chapter 10, verse 10. When you understand John 10, 10, the last aspect, and you apply it into your life, everything will run. That's why Jesus said, take no thought for tomorrow. You can't think out the future, but you can speak out the future. No matter the degree of your thinking, the future can still be the future, as bleak as it is, until you take over by the voice of faith. And when faith comes into reality, the future will be translated to your present, to what you want. Hallelujah. Abundant life is what you need to survive this harsh, troublesome, wicked world. Abundant life carries power. And that's why Paul was saying that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. If you check the ministry of Paul, check it carefully. Paul had no time to pray for things for himself. It was not a prayer point. Read his epistles. All what Paul was praying for, boldness to enter and preach the word of God. That's all. Paul did not have time. Gary, don't finish. Oh God, give us Gary. No. Do you know that Elijah, in the days of the famine in Israel, there was no prayer point for food? Listen, when you understand the concept of abundant life, there is a violent force that will come in you that will stir up the situation you are facing. And then you say, no, I cannot. He had no petition. Check all the great men of God in the scriptures who understood the concept of abundant life. They were living beyond the life of the present. The crash of the economy does not mean that your faith has crashed. I have never seen faith crash. Aeroplanes can crash, but faith cannot crash. Any day faith appears, faith is real. Praise the name of the Lord. There must be an anger in you to rebel against what you see in life. Until that anger comes in, you can't conquer. You must hate certain things you see around you. What you love, you attract. What you hate, it will run away from you. I've told this story several times of how in school I had to. There was no single money in my pocket, and I had to go about looking for just Gary to drink that money and go for lectures. I went to all what you call friends. That's why I've never believed in men. All what you call friends. And they all turned me down. When I got to the fifth friend, who I knew was well to do, I knew him. I know him. He turned me down. Then with my plate, like an almajiri, begging for food in a higher institution, a violent spirit came upon me, and I hated begging instantly. I turned my plate into heaven in front of his room, and I said, Lord, as long as I live, I will never by any chance stand before a mortal man to beg for anything. That was my prayer. Ladies and gentlemen, for over 20 years, I have not stood before any mortal man to beg for anything. My source has been him. Even if what I have left, my wife knows, if it is 50 naira in the house and is left 50 naira, I am not afraid. All what we do in our prayer is to say, Father, we thank you for your abundant supply. We don't pray for supply. Lord, we thank you for your abundant supply. And with the 50 naira, I go out. I've told you of the story. I went to the petrol station and I had no money. I had to fill my tank and go away. I have never stood before any mortal man to beg. Whether with style. You know, there is begging with style. When you put hand in your pocket with beautiful tie and suit. Oh boy, hi day, those days. Hi day. Meanwhile, you are coming to borrow. Begging in style. Whether in style or in reality, begging ceased in my life on that day. The only thing I could not remember to write down that date. And anytime I remember, it pains me. But I know that day very well. Until there is a holy anger in you concerning abundant life, you will not live where you are. Praise the name of the Lord. The devil fights the direction of the word and the destiny of the word. In Isaiah chapter 55 verse 11, the scripture says, so shall my word be that goeth out of my mouth shall not return unto me void. That word that has been sent will come back with a message to God of its accomplishment. From the day that word is sent, let me just demonstrate something. Praise the name of the Lord. I don't want to use pastors. All right, protocol, come. You are the best person. Protocol, come. Bishop has done this, but I want to just demonstrate it. Yes, you stand like that. You face the other side. Yeah. Now, this is how the word of God comes. When the word comes to you, it will come to him. as a person. As it comes to him as a person, God says, I am the beginning and the ending. In the beginning that the word comes to you, you are excited. You worship the Lord. You glorify his name. Now keep moving. As he begins to take steps to get to the end, it seems as though the world he's experiencing at this point is different from the world he had here. What is happening is that Satan is fighting the publication of the end of the world from the beginning. What he now needs to do at this stage is for his faith to be firm and stand strong, so he keeps going. At this point, there will be shakings. Sometimes it will be as if he's falling. But what will he do? As I'm shaking him, he keeps going. He doesn't mind the shaking until finally he hits him. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you very much. Hallelujah. You have to blow him. So what Satan does is to fight the word. He fights the word not to come to pass. He fights the destiny of the word. That's the location the word is going to stop, to make sure it doesn't stop. Jesus said, let us go over to the other side. That is Gennesaret. As he said that word, in the spirit world, they have already landed in Gennesaret. But physically, as he started sailing in the ship, what happened to him? A big tempest came. And the Bible said the ship was tossed to and fro, and Jesus was sleeping in that ship. And the men began to wrestle. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, you don't fight spiritual things with physical battles. That's a mistake so many people make. Hallelujah. They started troubling until when they remembered the voice of the word. They say, Master, carest not that we perish? He stood up. And what did he do? He rebuked the storm, and there was calm. Meaning that in the middle, there will be shaking. One of my flights from Abuja down, that morning, throughout the night, by the grace of God, I don't have time for bad dreams. I only fellowship with angels and with God when I sleep. So over the night, from when I lay my head on the pillow, all what he was singing is, in the hollow of his hands, throughout my sleep, in the hollow of his hands, I am saved, whatever may betide me, in the hollow of his hands, in the hollow of his hands, in the hollow of his hands, I am saved, whatever may I be, in the hollow of his hands. And that is the time that they have said they are locking up the Abuja airport for reconstruction, which they have not opened. And I was hurrying, and I had to book flight in excess of what I'm supposed to pay, just to make sure I get out of Abuja. Not knowing that they are going to defer it to the next day, I booked the flight. Finally, the information came that, in fact, the next flight for the other day, even less than 18,000, I can go. I say, what? Oh, God. But now I have booked, and throughout the night, he was just singing, in the hollow of his hand. God sees the beginning from the end.
He's the hollow of his hands. I am saved, whatever may betide me.
airport at the appointed time to book, which was about 5:55. No flight. We stayed there for over 1.5 hours. Then flight came. And I billed myself, I must be in Agua. And my wife was calling me. I said, I'm entering in Agua, whether we like it or not. We went into the flight. We stayed there for a long time on ground. Everything was set, and then we took off. As we were going, suddenly, the pilot announced that it is quite turbulent close to Port Harcourt. Meanwhile, as I woke up from my sleep that morning, in my prayers, sometimes God does not talk to or just keeps quiet. I was asking the Lord, what is the meaning of this song? Why should I be singing this song throughout the night? I'm fellowshipping with the angels with this song. He didn't say a word. So I just went ahead with my business. And then we were moving. Suddenly, I have never experienced such turbulence since I've been flying. As we were moving, we now wanted to descend. There was an announcement for descent. And as we were descending, heavy rain and storm coming. And this, as we were the pilot was running in a supersonic speed. I've never seen aircraft fly like that, just to land. And in that speed, the rain was throwing this plane, wah, this way. We come again, wah, this way. People were shouting. I was just calm. I mean, there was heavy fear. When you see storm carrying, not carrying plane and throwing him, destroying the plane this way. And before you know it, carries it again, then throws it. And we are running. Running. People were shouting, Jesus, help us. Jesus. I was just sitting where I was. Then in the midst of it, as the shakings were going on, then he reminded me the song. And then suddenly I started to sing that song in the plane. In the hollow of his hand. I've changed key, just go on. In the hollow of his hands, I am saved. Struck already, knowing that I was coming down, and that in the midst of the storm that I am in his hands, I should not fear. Hallelujah. The Bible says, Paul said, because I am in this ship, there shall be no loss of life. So God has said, I am there. So the plane cannot crash. Abundant life is carrying the plane. The plane is not the one carrying abundant life. So we were moving in that supersonic speed. And then finally, even when we are close to the ground, I could see the ground. But then the thing was running like a jet. My God, we did not land. We bounced. A plane lands, but this one landed. Boy, on the ground. Everybody shouted, praise the Lord. You know, hallelujah. What am I saying this evening? No matter the situation, God knows the beginning from the end.
Yes, sir.
And when you apply abundant life to whatever thing you are doing, no matter what you see, it will suddenly turn out for your good. Praise the Lord. Let's rise up to pray. In the hollow of his hands,
in the hollow of his hands,
I am saved.
voice and begin to claim abundant life over your life. Tell yourself, the life I shall begin to experience from today shall be no less a life than the one that Jesus gave me. I shall not be threatened by any circumstance. I cannot bow down to any situation, because God is in charge. He has solved the problem for me before I arrived. Oh God, I give you thanks for your life in me. Abundant life in me. Abundant life in me, Lord. Abundant life in me, Lord. That will crush every negative situation that comes near me. We give you praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.